Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 12995 in the name of Jackson Carlaw on behalf of the Citizen Participation Public Petitions Committee on Petition PE1887, Create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Jackson Carlaw to speak to and to move the motion on behalf of the Citizen Participation Public Petitions Committee. Mr. Carlaw.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and may I therefore begin by moving the motion in my name and start by saying what an absolute delight it is to be able to bring a petition for debate to the Chamber. And I say that because when this Parliament convened and I found that it fell to the Scottish Conservatives to convene the Public Petitions Committee for the first time in this Parliament, I fought very hard to have that opportunity because I happen to believe we have one of the finest petitions committee systems of any Parliament anywhere. And not just because of the issues of free personal care for the elderly, of the scandal of mesh, of extending care to those suffering from dementia at the age of 50, important issues which came to this Parliament through the Public Petitions Committee, but also through the various people that we hear from, including young Callum Eisted in this Parliament, who at the age of 7 was the youngest person ever to bring a petition before this Parliament. Now, he left a little disappointed in one respect, Deputy Presiding Officer, because when Nicola Sturgeon was First Minister, she promised him a tour of Bute House, but unfortunately left office before that promise could be fulfilled. And I catch out the corner of my eye a man who might be able to fix that sin of omission. And I can say to him he will have the undying gratitude of the Public Petitions Committee if young Callum Eisted may finally have the opportunity of that tour. We wait to see whether or not that promise can be fulfilled. But I also, Presiding Officer, bring petitions to this, this Parliament. And I always say this, not with the mandate of any party election manifesto, but with the mandate of the petitioner themselves. And that is what motivates the Public Petitions Committee and unites us invariably behind the aims of a petition. And so very much today, on behalf of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee, but also on behalf of the petitioner Nicola Murray and all those affected by the issues raised in this petition. Mr. Swinney.
John Swinney.
Grateful to Mr. Carlaw for giving way. And before he leaves the point about the comparison of the petition systems, I think it is a point that should be recognised about what has been in the development of the Scottish Parliament of an effective parliamentary petition system. Because in my experience in the House of Commons, petitions really arrived and went nowhere. Whereas I think it's very obvious here, petitions come in and they can end up occupying the afternoon business of the parliamentary chamber, which is a commendation of the strength of the parliamentary rules here and also of the work of the petitions committee.
Jackson Carlaw.
Yes, I thank Mr. Swinney for that observation. And I suppose I might also observe at the recent conveners group with the sitting First Minister, we were able to take forward a petition to secure free transport for asylum seekers, which the First Minister was able to give a commitment and promise to include in the legislative programme at that time. So it's a committee that can achieve things. But I'm also pleased that this petition lodged in 2021 by Nicola, she has joined us in the public gallery today along with members of her family. And it calls for the creation of a specific offence that enables courts to hand down longer sentences where miscarriage has been caused through acts and domestic violence. And in considering the issues raised by the petition, the committee was fortunate enough to hear directly from Nicola. And I'd like to thank her really for the courage and determination she demonstrated in sharing her harrowing experience with us back in 2022. It's no small matter to come to a Parliament and discuss these issues. We must not underestimate how daunting it is to share your personal experiences and present your case to a parliamentary committee. And Nicola has also supported and campaigned on behalf of other women who have suffered pregnancy loss as a result of domestic abuse. And her resolve was instrumental in our decision to bring her petition to the Chamber today. We also held a roundtable session with Stephen Tidy from Victim Support Scotland, Dr Mary Neal from the University of Strathclyde, and Dr Marcia Scott from Scottish Women's Aid. And I'll refer to their evidence during my remarks. Currently, there is a legal framework for responding to domestic abuse, and we recognise in particular the Scottish Government's recent work through the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act of 2018. The Act created a new statutory offence of domestic abuse, and in particular, it allows for physical, psychological and controlling behaviour that is carried out over a sustained period of time to be prosecuted as a single course of conduct. And the maximum penalty for an offence under the Act is imprisonment for a term of up to 14 years. A joint protocol exists between Police Scotland and the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service to outline how domestic abuse cases should be handled. But what the current legal framework does not do is specifically recognise pregnancy loss as a result of domestic abuse. And we heard about the impact on victims and the importance of having this specific type of abuse recognised in the justice system. We also heard that pregnancy can act as a trigger for the abuse to begin in the first place, and that abuse can intensify during the pregnancy. And we recognise that at any time, pregnancy can be a very vulnerable time for any woman. Now, the evidence gathered to date has been profoundly moving and extremely effective. And I must say, in bringing the committee to a view on this issue, we made two recommendations to the Scottish Government following our evidence taking. The first of these was that the Scottish Government should undertake a review and evaluation of the effectiveness of the current legal framework in bringing forward and prosecuting charges of this nature. Because we heard that in cases of domestic abuse, there are problems with the system, from initial contact with the police through to charging and prosecuting perpetrators. There have been positive steps, with additional Police Scotland funding to support training on the implementation of the Domestic Abuse Act. But despite this, it is clear that we can still do more to support survivors of domestic abuse. Nicola expressed that the justice system fails on many levels when it comes to domestic abuse, and that it deters women from even reporting in the first place. Stakeholders warned us that reporting figures could be underrepresenting the scale of the problem because of the significant barriers to disclosure faced by women. And we heard that these barriers might be particularly acute in cases of coercive and controlling behaviour. Scottish Women's Aid told us that coercive and controlling behaviour is the single variable that best predicts lethality. So it is critical that, if nothing else, police officers are able to identify whether coercive and controlling behaviours are being exhibited. Women's Aid also shared concerns that police risk assessments focus on the physical abuse. We were told that women don't get the help and support they need when they first reach out, and that they will be deterred from seeking help in future. Nicola told the committee that it is a lottery as to whether the responding police officers will be knowledgeable about domestic abuse, and that in fact some officers will advise women that reporting is a waste of time, or even blame victims for what they have gone through. Now, we understand that Police Scotland is working to improve its response to domestic abuse, and that it's time for the Domestic Abuse Act to be fully effective. However, we heard that Scotland has an implementation disorder and more needs to be done. We were concerned to hear that victims do not feel informed and supported when they report domestic abuse. And at the point of taking cases to court, we were told that communication is lacking, particularly where charges are reduced, and that the process of seeking justice often traumatised the victims. Now, in one of Nicola's cases, the perpetrator took a deal to lessen his charge. In the end, he was ordered to pay her just £300 compensation for the loss of her unborn child. Now, Nicola described this as deeply inappropriate, considering the trauma that was caused to her. And we even heard of another case where the perpetrator was ordered to pay just £50 in compensation for his actions. And while this is not a political point, it's worth noting that provisions in other parts of the United Kingdom are much stronger in relation to the statutory offence of child destruction as an aggravating factor. In February last year, the then Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans responded to our recommendations by highlighting research projects on the experiences of witnesses in domestic abuse cases. And I look forward to hearing an update from the Cabinet Secretary. And I come to the second and more significant recommendation, and that is that the committee recommended that legislation be brought forward to create a specific statutory offence or a statutory aggravator for causing miscarriage through acts of violence. We heard from Nicola that when she lost her pregnancies, it impacted on the entire family, and she was deeply traumatised and emotional. And I now quote from Nicola as I conclude. "It is life-impacting, not just for the victims, but for their families. When I lost my pregnancies, I lost a child, I lost children. My children lost siblings, my parents lost grandchildren, so it impacts the entire family. Obviously, afterwards, it's deeply traumatising and emotional. It's not just that you have to deal with the loss itself, it's the circumstances of the loss and the fact that the perpetrator can get away with it so easily. It's often the case that they are not even charged at all. However, if they are, the sentencing is inappropriate, which is like rubbing salt in the wounds of victims. It's almost like saying to them that what happened meant nothing, that can add further trauma to the victims and their families because they feel they have not received justice. I'm very lucky," she said, "that I have such an amazing family. My mum has been a tremendous support. I really do not know what I would have done without her. However, a lot of women I engage with do not have family support, for whatever reason. They might have to flee their homes and their support network of friends. They feel very vulnerable, very let down, and at times almost hopeless. We need to change that, and we need to have an opportunity to do that. So on behalf of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee, I hope that we can play a part in considering how we recognise, how we support, and how we find justice for victims of this harrowing form of domestic abuse. And I very much look forward to hearing the government's response and for the debate that will follow this afternoon."
Thank you, Mr. Carnov. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance on behalf of the Scottish Government. The Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I too very much welcome the opportunity to participate in today's debate. And I would firstly wish to thank and commend the convener and members of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee for their consideration of the petition from Ms Nicola Murray. And I too would like to welcome Ms Murray to this Parliament, to her Parliament. It is evident to all that the circumstances outlined by Ms Murray and which have driven today's debate are shattering and deeply heartbreaking, and something which no woman should ever have to endure. The petition reflects the most tragic of circumstances from a relationship that was based on the cruel realities of domestic abuse, something which I am committed to address and to respond to as best I can, an endeavour I know that all parliamentarians share. When I was first asked by the committee to consider the petition, I knew I would have to wrestle with the natural instinct to respond positively to these tragic circumstances with some of the realities of my role and responsibilities as Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs. But I do very much come to this debate today in the spirit of cooperation, collaboration and compassion. We all want to focus on doing what is right, what is deliverable, and what will make a difference. As we've heard from Mr. Carlaw, the petition seeks to create a specific criminal offence which would allow the courts to place longer sentences on those convicted of domestic abuse which causes the loss of an unborn child. As a matter of principle, I can fully understand the reasons for this request, rooted as it is in the belief that the current law cannot adequately punish individuals who cause the loss of an unborn child through their violent actions or coercive control. And I noted on the committee's website that there were a number of written submissions alongside those from the Scottish Government. And there are some challenges that we need to think through, to consider what the consequences of progressing such a proposal might be, to evaluate what other options might already exist that currently seek to deliver the same outcome, but also, of course, to consider what else may be required. It is important, firstly, to consider how the current legislative framework responds to the circumstances outlined in the petition. As we've already heard from Mr. Carlaw, the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 created that specific course of conduct offence for the first time, enabling physical, psychological and controlling behaviour to be prosecuted together. The Act makes it a criminal offence for a person to engage in a course of behaviour which is abusive of their partner or ex-partner. The Act criminalises not only physical abuse, but other forms of psychological abuse and coercive and controlling behaviour that were previously difficult to prosecute. In addition, the Act provides a non-exhaustive definition of what is considered abusive behaviour for the operation of the domestic abuse offence. And the Act therefore recognises the multifaceted nature of domestic abuse. And furthermore, Section 1 of the Act allows imprisonment for a term of up to 14 years. And while I absolutely acknowledge the significant difference between the maximum penalty under the Act and the penalty received in the respect of the case of the petitioner, and with respect, and I hope members will understand that I have, of course, explained in correspondence to committee that there are, of course, independent functions for Police Scotland and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service to investigate and prosecute cases under legislation, which, of course, is independent to ministers. I will, of course, return to what ministers can do. When considering any reports submitted by the police, prosecutors apply the prosecution test set out in their published prosecution code and exercise professional judgment in deciding on the most appropriate charges based on the facts and circumstances of each case. Where there is evidence that a victim has suffered severe injury, including miscarriage, as a result of the accused actions, this injury would be reflected both within the charge libelled against the accused and the forum selected for the prosecution of that offence. And I am aware that the petitioner and others have called for an amendment to the 2018 Act that reflects the impact of the death of an unborn child because of their concerns that current laws are not fit for purpose. As things stand, in terms of our current legislation, the law can ensure that the death of an unborn child is provided appropriate recognition within the criminal justice system. However, that does not mean there is not further action, either legislatively or non-legislatively, that should be pursued. Of course.
Jamie Green.
Thank you. I've listened intently to what the Cabinet Secretary had to say just there. But that is in relation to the manner in which the Crown prosecutes and under which legislation it uses to prosecute. What is specifically being asked in the petition is that some form of aggravator is involved in the sentencing, and it is therefore the sentencing which needs to be looked at. And that is a matter that this Parliament has addressed in the past in the way that it informs the Sentencing Council guidelines, and I think it can do so again. I'm yet to hear what the objections or limitations are to us doing that.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I will come to some of the areas that we need to think and feel our way through, but I'll also come to the legitimate points around the merits of aggravated offences. Presiding Officer, while I cannot comment on specific cases, I do know that Section 1 of the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Act 2016 can and has been used in similar circumstances to that of the petitioner, where the offence was aggravated by abuse of a partner or ex-partner, where the commission of any offence amounts to domestic violence. And such examples have included custodial sentences being imposed. So this demonstrates that the law in Scotland can be utilised successfully in such circumstances. That's not withstanding the merits of further debate around other actions, which I'll touch upon a wee bit later. I do share some of the committee's reflections about the clear and evident difficulties in the desire to create a new offence in this area, not least in terms of how it could be proven. It is likely to prove difficult, both medically and causally, to demonstrate, for example, that psychological abuse led to a woman's miscarriage. Any change to the law in this area would also need to consider the possibility of unintended consequences, something which the committee discussed during its deliberations, including the request to extend the law into other areas. And I suppose to get to one of Mr Green's points, examples could include an unhelpful focus on the behaviour of mothers and other household members that may lead to a miscarriage and stillbirth and prosecution for child destruction. And I noted very carefully the evidence from Dr. Marcia Scott when she spoke to the legislative provision that is currently available in England and Wales, but also her concerns that there were victims, there were women victims who were being prosecuted for child destruction. And I say that only in that we need to give matters careful consideration to reach the aims that we want, but to avoid unintended consequences. Mr Green and others have also mentioned the Scottish Sentencing Council, who have clearly stated the opportunities that the court has, that there's nothing to preclude the loss of an unborn child caused by violent actions or coercive control being libelled as part of an offence. However, I also note the work that the Sentencing Council are progressing to develop a guideline on domestic abuse offences, and I await the conclusion to that work. Further to that work, Presiding Officer, I will ensure that the concerns expressed by the petitioner, that that forms part of the discussions of the Scottish Government-led Domestic Abuse Justice Partners Roundtable, and I will endeavour to keep members fully informed. In closing, I would reference the comment from Marcia Scott from Scottish Women's Aid, who said that I think the law has the tools that we need, and I referenced such a tool that has been used in the circumstances described by the petitioner. There are also other actions beyond the law that we need to consider. But I will end my remarks, Presiding Officer, by saying that I will continue to listen and to reflect on the contribution of members this afternoon. I will touch more on the arguments in and around aggravated offences in my closing remarks. And once again, I commend the bravery of the lady who brought this petition to her attention.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Pam Gozo on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Ms Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am honoured to open today's important debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives on the creation of an Unborn Victims of Violence Act. I would like to begin by also commending and thanking Nicola Murray for bringing this petition to the Parliament. Nicola lost her baby due to domestic abuse after her partner drove a car at her when she was 6 weeks pregnant. 4 years later, she then went on to lose a second pregnancy in similar circumstances. She has since been campaigning for the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, creating a particular offence that enables courts to hand down longer sentences for perpetrators of domestic violence which causes a miscarriage. Nicola's unwavering determination and courage in advocating for this cause has unquestionably advanced the discourse, will potentially go on to influence legislation, and ultimately will result in the preservation of numerous lives. Aside from this petition, she set up a Brodie's Trust to support women who have lost babies because of domestic violence or forced termination. The Trust provides a safe space for women to share their grief and trauma. The horrifying act of domestic abuse and its impact on pregnant mothers is often overshadowed in the debate. Pregnancy loss is a deeply personal and often traumatic experience on its own, and it takes an even darker hue when intertwined with the web of domestic violence. Behind every statistic lies a story of pain, or of shattered dreams and of lives forever altered. It's a reality that many endure in silence, plagued by fear, shame and a sense of powerlessness. But we must confront these uncomfortable truths to pave the way for the future where every pregnancy can be met with joy. Every home is a sanctuary and every individual is free from the shackles of abuse. Domestic abuse is rampant in Scotland and almost 62,000 recorded incidents of abuse last year alone. In 2022, it was reported that every day, four pregnant women are the victims of domestic abuse. Nicola Murray's abuser was convicted of reckless conduct and ordered to pay £300 compensation. Another case of justice not served was raised with the Scottish Parliament's Petition Committee. In 2019, Stephen Ramsay stabbed, punched and throttled his pregnant partner, Lisa Donaldson. He caused her a spinal cord injury, brain damage, extensive bruising and numerous other injuries. She had been 32 weeks pregnant with twins, who both died as a result. Ramsay received 5 years in prison for attempted murder. Comparatively, elsewhere in the UK, he could have received a life sentence for child destruction. In England, Wales and Northern Ireland, deliberate acts of violence resulting in the death of late-term fetus can lead to criminal charges. This has been applied alongside other offences like assault and murder, as seen in the case of R versus Wilson, where the perpetrator received a life sentence for causing grievous bodily harm with intent and child destruction, with a minimum term of 14 years. While nothing can heal the profound loss suffered in such cases, stricter sentences could play a pivotal role in deterring abusers. While acknowledging the gravity of domestic violence-induced miscarriages, pregnant victims of domestic abuse face an agonising battle to protect both themselves and their unborn children. The Scottish Government and the Crown Office have assured that crimes of this measure are covered by existing legislation. But campaigners and the victim support organisations believe the existing legal framework falls short. This week, I've had conversations with five survivors of domestic abuse, and each story reveals a system that has let them down. Whether it's a lenient sentence, repeated breaches of bail orders, or plea deals struck without the victim's knowledge, the failures are glaring. Too often, lenient sentences fall short of reflecting the gravity of the crime, allowing abusers to roam free and potentially re-offend. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the debate on the creation of an Unborn Victims of Violence Act is crucial. It is imperative to enhance protections for pregnant women and their unborn children from violent perpetrators. The Scottish Conservatives remain steadfast in advocating for victims and are committed to exploring effective measures to combat this aberrant crime.
Thank you, Ms Gozo. I now call on Pauline McNeill on behalf of Scottish Labour. Ms McNeill.
Thank you. I agree with Jackson Carlow about the importance of the Public Petitions Committee and his excellent speech today, and I wish him well with his endeavours for young Callum to visit Bute House. One of the hardest things a woman may ever have to go through is a miscarriage, but it doesn't bear thinking about that miscarriage could be caused by the violence of a partner. I too would like to join with others in welcoming Nicola Murray to the gallery, the petitioner, and bringing this issue to the Petitions Committee and the Parliament. She is absolutely right when she says the system fails victims, and it fails victims of domestic violence. As we have discussed before across the parties, male violence is already a scar in society, and it's even more shocking when men commit violence on pregnant women, and the law must be able to deal with those men. The pain and worry of protecting your own self as well as the child you're carrying is unimaginable. I too was surprised to learn that domestic violence often increases when a woman is pregnant or even begins at this time. This is true for all women, not just those from social disadvantaged backgrounds. Pregnancy is an especially dangerous time if you're in an abusive relationship. And as we know, abuse is based on power and control, and it's common for an abusive partner to become resentful or jealous. resulting in further escalation of violence. A woman is more vulnerable when she is pregnant, and the abuser knows that and uses it to gain more control. The World Health Organization tells us that 1 in 3 women worldwide have experienced physical or sexual violence at the hands of an intimate partner. And sometimes pregnancy alters the pattern of assault, with pregnant women more likely to be struck on the abdomen or have multiple sites of injury. And women experience domestic abuse when pregnant are much more likely to have babies born prematurely or with low birth weight, both of which are leading causes of neonatal mortality. Over 7,000 domestic incidents were reported between 2017 and 2021 to Police Scotland, with the victims also identified as being pregnant, equating to 4 women every day. And the number is likely to be far lower than the reality, though, with many pregnant women scared to report abuse, worrying their child may end up being taken into care. In fact, it is estimated that fewer than 1 in 5 cases of domestic abuse are reported to the police. So we do need more deterrence, and I agree with Pam Gossel very much on that point. And as well as the interventions already provided for the NHS for victims of domestic abuse, we do need tough sentences for those abusers who cause a miscarriage when a woman is pregnant. Scottish Labour supported Domestic Abuse Act 2018 and as a key means of introducing tough sentences for those convicted of abusing their partners or ex-partners. But I want to address the question of the law that the Cabinet Secretary also did. Scots law is different in nature to English and Welsh law. We have a common law system for the courts to consider issues such as miscarriage or forced termination as a serious aggravation of domestic abuse when sentencing, and it can take into account harm to children. It was the question I think we do need to examine is whether or not the law is being used to its full effect. I agree with others that the loss of a child caused by violence should be led as evidence in any court case. We need to be clear that it is a crime in itself, but the question is whether Scots law adequately covers it, or is there scope for further exploration if it does not? And I think the point that Jamie Green was making was about the importance of the Sentencing Council addressing that in its guidance. The petition proposes a specific offence of an unborn victim of violence similar to England and Wales and Northern Ireland, but England, of course, has a much more statutory, rigid system of law than in Scotland. Indeed, a specific offence such as the crime of child destruction would obviously have to be proved separately from the original charge, and it's not clear to me how successful it's been in England and Wales. But it's clear in legal terms, a clear causal link would need to be proved in those cases. And arguably, Scots law, the burden of proof is lesser. The petition raises a hugely important subject, that the loss of a wanted pregnancy is a unique and traumatic kind of harm to women, distinct to the injuries suffered during an attack. And this is an important opportunity to explore if there are indeed gaps in our law. Also, as is clear, it hasn't been through a subject committee, so I think today is about examining the preliminary issues and decide whether or not there's further scope for this Parliament to do more work. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. And I now call on Maggie Chapman on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin this afternoon, as others have already done, by paying tribute to the petitioner, Nicola Murray. Her testimony has been both extraordinarily courageous and utterly heartbreaking. I extend my personal sorrow for her suffering and multiple losses, my solidarity with her anger at the way the criminal justice system has let her down, and my admiration for her years of work. That work includes not only her engagement with this Parliament, but the creation of Brodie's Trust, supporting others who have undergone similar experiences, and campaigning together for a change in the law. I would also like to thank Jackson Carlaw and the Petitions Committee for its careful and sensitive work on this serious issue and for securing today's important debate. I'm grateful to all who gave evidence during the committee's discussion of this petition, and to the committee clerks and others for the information they've collated for us today. As others have already pointed out, and as we've heard in the evidence as this petition went through the committee process, today is not a debate about reproductive rights. The petitioner made this very clear in her original petition information, and clarified this again in her evidence and written submissions. The title of the petition, unfortunately, in my view, carries echoes of the United States Unborn Victims of Violence Act. That Act is a deeply problematic law first introduced by anti-choice Republican Lindsey Graham, best known perhaps for his dramatic conversion to the cause of Donald Trump. That Act is not what the petitioner is calling for, and it's crucial that we recognise this. For the body of the petition and its supporting evidence highlight a malignant yet disregarded scandal. The domestic abuse inflicted upon women by intimate partners during pregnancy and following childbirth. And the impact, the life-changing, the life-ending impact that such domestic abuse has. And as Jackson Carlow said earlier, Nicola spoke so eloquently about her experience of just this. It's difficult to ascertain quite how prevalent this abuse is. Answers depend on how and when questions are asked. Rates of reporting are understandably low, especially where women are financially dependent on their abuser. But the evidence we do have reveals appalling levels of physical, emotional, and sexual violence. That's both pre-existent abuse that is exacerbated during pregnancy and after the birth of a baby, and new abuse triggered by those events. The petitioner's own Freedom of Information request to Police Scotland shows that reported cases average 4 every single day. The real number is, of course, likely to be many times higher than this. The petitioner has outlined her own experience, experiences both of the original abuse and of traumatic treatment by the criminal justice system. I profoundly hope that these systemic problems will be effectively addressed by the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill. I spoke earlier in the session about the importance of that bill, and I will be fighting hard to ensure that it remains robust and radical in protecting the rights of survivors, such as the petitioner. But we need more. As Dr. Mary Neal's submission to the Criminal Justice Committee during Stage 1 of the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 detailed exactly what was needed. Her proposed offences were not included in that act, and that maybe now looks like a missed opportunity. I and my Scottish Green colleagues agree with the recommendations of the committee, or the Petitions Committee. I have mentioned already the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill and the hopes pinned thereon. But we need to be open too to the need for other mechanisms of review and evaluation that go beyond the legislation to support survivors through the criminal justice system. I also believe that there should be a statutory aggravator for causing miscarriage through violence. I hope the petitioner and others will understand we maybe cannot support the petition in its precise current form, owing to the ambiguity of its title, because this could, against the petitioner's own wishes, be used to undermine essential reproductive rights. But we do need action, urgent action, including legislative change, to address this particular and tragic form of abuse. I'm interested in exploring some of the potential issues or barriers around new legislation that the Cabinet Secretary has alluded to, but I am very willing to work with the petitioner, her organisation and others across the Chamber to explore how this can be done and done effectively. Dr. Neal has suggested amending the 2018 Act. This is perhaps the logical pathway and I would personally support it, while being aware that it would need considerable time as well as priority in a busy parliamentary timetable. The issue is, of course, related both to the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform and the misogyny bills, and so there might be perhaps the possibility of amendment there too. I do look forward to hearing more contributions in the debate this afternoon and to returning to some of those practical possibilities later on in my closing speech. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Chapman. We will now move to the open debate. I call Claire Hockey to be followed by Maurice Golden. Ms. Hockey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would like, as others have, to begin by thanking colleagues on the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee for their work on this issue and those stakeholders who have engaged with them. And I would also like to commend the bravery and tenacity of the petitioner, Nicola Murray, in bringing this issue to the Parliament and sharing her personal testimony, described by the committee as profoundly moving, about a subject that could not be more sensitive or personal. Her ongoing work to create spaces for other women who have experienced the loss of a pregnancy through violence or abuse, to provide comfort and support to each other is invaluable to many. Through her work, the shocking reality of the scale of this issue has been brought into sharp focus. Every day in Scotland, 4 pregnant women will be the victim of domestic violence. These already stark figures are likely to be underreported based on what we know about the reporting of domestic violence more generally. And pregnancy is one of the most dangerous times for victims of domestic abuse. Presiding officer, almost 1 in 3 women who suffer abuse experience it for the first time whilst they are pregnant. This makes domestic abuse the most commonly experienced threat to the health and well-being of women during pregnancy. As many across the chamber will recognise from their constituents, violence against women causes devastating physical and psychological impacts for its victims and has wide-ranging costs for them, their families and their communities as a whole. Brodie's Trust, set up by the petitioner, have reported that many women who have suffered pregnancy loss as a result of abuse have never spoken about what happened to them before finding the group. They brought with them deep and significant trauma, often wrapped up in self-blame. All too often, their experiences are still hidden. The Domestic Abuse Scotland Act was a welcome step forward in creating new statutory offences in domestic abuse, making it easier for certain forms of abuse and coercive and controlling behaviour to be prosecuted. The briefing notes from that time state that the loss of a pregnancy as the result of domestic abuse could still be considered as an important factor in sentencing. However, as it stands in Scots law, there is no specific offence of ending a pregnancy through violence or abusive behaviour. In other parts of the UK, the Infant Life Preservation Act may be used to prosecute someone who attacks a pregnant woman and causes the loss of her unborn child. However, this piece of legislation stands alone and I understand is nearly 100 years old. Across Scotland, campaigners like the petitioner Nicola and other groups, organisations and stakeholders work tirelessly every day to protect, advocate for and support victims of domestic violence. And recently I spoke in chamber about how it is imperative that we treat victims and survivors of crime with compassion and we owe it to them to listen to and to act upon their experiences and concerns. We must do more to ensure not only do they feel treated with compassion, but they must also feel that they have received the justice that they deserve and the perpetrator the punishment that they are due. Domestic violence is a pernicious issue and there is much work to be done in changing attitudes and breaking stigma and taboos. Presiding officer, the loss of a pregnancy is always heartbreaking. When such a loss is caused by abuse or through violence, the trauma and emotional pain surely must be magnified beyond recognition. It's for this reason that I welcome the opportunity to speak on this issue today and that I thank the committee for bringing this to the chamber. But most of all, I thank Nicola for bringing this petition to Parliament.
Thank you, Ms Hockey. I now call Maurice Golden to be followed by Fulton MacGregor. Mr Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Citizens Participation in Public Petitions Committee considers a lot of petitions on a whole range of issues. And it's very rare that one of those issues makes it to a full debate in this chamber. So for this and for the efforts to ensure this issue is given the consideration and awareness it deserves, I pay tribute to the petitioner, Nicola Murray. But I'm sure that this Parliament debating this very important issue gives very little solace to Nicola and the thousands of other women who have suffered and continue to suffer from domestic abuse, particularly those who have lost an unborn child as a result of that abuse. As a recently appointed member of the Public Petitions Committee, I was not on the committee to hear Nicola's evidence, but the transcript is a harrowing read, and the impact is clearly distressing and traumatic, not only for Nicola, but also for our children and other family members. And what is evident is that Nicola has been badly let down by a justice system. Her ex-partner hit her with his car, and she miscarried less than 40 hours later due to her injuries. In addition to the loss of her unborn child and the grief she suffers from, she has been left with permanent left side weakness, difficulty walking for long periods, pain in her back, hip, pelvis, and complex PTSD. His sentence was to pay Nicola £300 compensation. Through Nicola's personal tragedy, the women she supports and her own research shows that her experience is far from an isolated one. In addition to the petitioner's case, I was also struck by the case highlighted by Dr. Mary Neal in her submission to the committee, whereby she cited the example of a man who stabbed, punched, and throttled his partner, who was 32 weeks pregnant with twins, causing her spinal cord injury, brain damage, extensive bruising, and numerous other injuries. Both unborn babies died as a result of the attack, yet the perpetrator only received 5 years imprisonment for attempted murder. And whether the sentence is evidence that a specific offence is required or an indictment of the current state of Scotland's justice system or both, it is clear that the status quo is not good enough when it comes to handing down sentences when a miscarriage has been caused through domestic violence. Elsewhere in the UK, the perpetrator could and likely would have received a life sentence. On numerous occasions, life sentences have been handed down for similar crimes throughout the UK under the crime of child destruction, and whereby, in her submission, Dr. Mary Neal has clearly pointed out the shortcomings in the existing crime of child destruction does not make it clear that this legislation can be used to prosecute a partner or ex-partner that deliberately causes the death of late-term fetus through violence, whereas in Scotland, no specific legislation exists. I note the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs in her submission to the committee, where she states that the Scottish Government are not persuaded that a new offence should be introduced and believe legislating in this area could be difficult and unintended consequences must be considered. But it doesn't seem good enough to say unintended consequences must be considered in a way that suggests this is a reason not to introduce a new law. As with all new laws, it is the job of this Parliament to ensure unintended consequences are fully considered when introducing new legislation. In the petitioner's view, she has said, "I am steadfast in my belief that within domestic abuse law is the natural home for this amendment, and that the wording by Dr. Mary Neal leaves no room for misinterpretation and unintended consequences for women." The Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee position on the issue is clear and recommends that the Scottish Government brings forward legislation to create a specific statutory offence and/or statutory aggravator for causing miscarriage through acts of domestic violence. So whether it is an amendment to domestic abuse laws or through some other mechanism, I would urge the Scottish Government to look at this issue again and give further consideration to legislating in this area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Golden. I now call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to open my speech today by thanking Nicola Murray and all those who helped the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee for all their hard work on bringing this petition through the committee process and to the Chamber today. I know that Nicola has gone on record to talk about her harrowing personal motivations for raising this issue, and her diligent work must be commended. The petition seeks to introduce the creation of a specific criminal offence enabling the courts to impose longer sentences for perpetrators of domestic abuse which causes the loss of an unborn child. The petition also suggests to us that the current legislation is unable to effectively prosecute those who cause the loss of an unborn child through their violent actions or coercive control. All of us in the Chamber today can agree that abusive behaviour which results in miscarriage is detestable, and those who engage in such behaviour must be held to account. This is not something that should ever happen to anyone, and the unfathomable pain that this experience can cause should be recognised. And, Presiding Officer, If I can reflect for a second on my own time as a social worker, we've seen domestic violence regularly. And as others have said, such as Pauline McNeill and Claire Hawkey, it was actually often noted that pregnancy for a woman was a time of increased risk of domestic violence, whether that was within a current domestically abusive relationship or it signalled the beginning of domestic abuse, which is something that should absolutely shock us all. And although I worked in that sector, continues to shock me even speaking about it. Presiding officer, the challenge that the Scottish Government do have, however, when looking at this petition is balancing the acknowledgement of the gravity of these experiences with analysing any potential challenges that introducing new legislation can bring. When researching potential new legislation, the Scottish Government must also look at whether there are ways in which similar results may be achieved without having to introduce new acts. In examining the laws that are currently in place, the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018, which was taken through in the last session, created a new statutory offence of domestic abuse. It sets out three conditions, all of which must be proven for a conviction. The accused engaged in a course of behaviour which was abusive of the accused partner or ex-partner. A reasonable person would consider the course of behaviour to be likely to cause the partner or ex-partner to suffer physical or psychological harm, and that the accused either intended the course of behaviour to cause such harm or was reckless as to whether it would. This behaviour includes actions which are violent as well as threatening and intimidating. By recognising that abusive behaviour can be psychological as well as physical, this Act acknowledges that domestic abuse is very much a multifaceted issue. And at this point, presiding officer, I'd like to mention of one of my constituents, Carla Basu, who has recently won the prestigious Royal Television Society Scotland Student Award for her film Bruised, which deals with this, with the varying types of domestic abuse and the support available to survivors. And I'm currently, presiding officer, looking at organising a screening of Bruised in Holyrood. And when I get the invite out for that, I would encourage all members to attend. As we know, it is for Police Scotland and for the COPFS to investigate and prosecute cases under this domestic abuse offence. And as well as statutory law, common law may be used to bring a perpetrator to justice. The common law offence of assault could be used in instances when an abuser causes a victim to miscarry or even force a woman to terminate her pregnancy against her will. The maximum penalty for the common law offence of assault ranges up to life imprisonment and is limited only by the sentencing powers of the court in which the case is heard. With these powers already existing, the Scottish Government, as we've heard, is not convinced at this time that a new offence should be introduced. But it may be, however, that a bit more thought does need to be given to this area. And one way to do this may be through the Sentencing Council. As mentioned earlier, the penalties for assault are only limited by the sentencing powers of the court in which the case is heard. In correspondence with the committee, the Scottish Sentencing Council acknowledged that the evidence-based approach to guideline development and noted that they were at an early stage of gathering evidence in preparation for developing a guideline in domestic abuse offences. The Sentencing Council have also said that in their own evidence sessions, they would consider all the evidence already gathered by the committee regarding this petition. Presently, the domestic abuse guideline is currently at stage two of processing, and we must let the Council independently progress through these stages, but there is possibly scope there. In conclusion, presiding officer, the petition has brought attention to a very real and serious issue that deplorably occurs in Scotland today. Although we can agree that the reasons for this proposed new legislation are legitimate, we must also be sure to fully examine what legal challenges and unintended consequences, although I accept the point that Maurice Golden made, but we must analyse what consequences exist with any new legislation. I would conclude by thanking Nicola again for bringing the petition to the Parliament and ask that the Government continue to give full consideration to this issue in any way they can help. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by John Swinney. Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In 2018, the Scottish Parliament passed its Domestic Abuse Bill. It was said at that time to be landmark legislation and the momentous day for survivors of domestic abuse in Scotland. In this case, we should be proud of the work of the Parliament. But as this petition and the evidence we've heard make clear, more work has to be done to support those subject to domestic abuse. According to the National Centre for Domestic Violence, one in four women will experience domestic abuse in their lives. And in the most recent statistics, 61% of lodged incidents of domestic abuse did not include the recording of a crime or offence. Yet, we must keep in mind the true rate of the abuse is likely to be much greater than what is reported. The National Centre for Domestic Violence estimates less than 24% of the domestic abuse crime is reported to the police. This should be greatly concerning. Last year, the Crime and Justice Committee report on the implementation of the Domestic Abuse Bill outlined several areas in need of improvement. Police need to be fully trained in recognising domestic abuse, particularly of a non-violent physiological nature. Some survivors felt that building a case against non-physical abuse was too difficult, and the use of time-limited non-harassment orders caused survivors to leave their homes upon their expiration. The evidence seen by the committee with this petition demonstrates pregnancy amplifies the barrier which survivors face in reporting domestic abuse. Four a day, four pregnant women every day in Scotland face domestic abuse. And research from the University of Edinburgh shows that domestic abuse becomes more likely when a woman is pregnant. Nicola Murray, who brought this petition to the Scottish Parliament, outlined in her harrowing evidence to the committee that we are failing survivors. The fear of having to see your abuser again in the court and having to relive your trauma. The lottery as to whether the police pursue a case and survivors being told without being consulted their case was being closed. And pregnant survivors or those with young children often avoid reporting their abuse for fear they will be seen as bad mother or their children will be taken from them. Empowering survivors so they can go to the police, so they can leave their abusers and get support to break the cycle of abuse must be made paramount by this Parliament. On healthcare this week, I'm sure many of you have spoken to, held in our hearts, they are calling for a minimum bereavement framework for women who have lost baby. They also describe as postcode lottery on care for bereavement mothers. Where care is available, there is no personalised one-to-one support, inclusive of both families and mothers. In the evidence heard by the committee and from the conversation I had with held in our hearts, we are failing women who have lost their child. The introduction of the book Pregnancy and Baby Loss prior to 24 weeks is a good start to officially recognising the grief of losing a pregnancy. But universal personal support is needed. To conclude, Presiding Officer, this petition has raised important issues which too many women across Scotland face. We must recognise the immense pain at losing a child to domestic abuse. In regard to domestic abuse and supporting women who have lost a child, it is clear we are failing on multiple levels. The unacceptable increase of domestic abuse when women become pregnant must be investigated, and our system of the support for victims of domestic abuse should reflect that reality. Laws need to be better implemented and enforced so no abuser goes unpunished or underpunished. And mothers need to have access to counselling and other support so no one is left to suffer in silence. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call John Swinney to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Mr. Swinney.
Presiding Officer, can I begin with the speech from Jackson Carlow, the convener of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee, because I think in two respects it was an outstanding speech to open this debate. The first was in explaining something which I don't think gets nearly enough airtime, the significance of the and the effectiveness of the public petitions process within this Parliament, and it is one of the jewels in the crown of the identity of this Parliament. The second element of the importance of Mr Carlow's speech was the recognition of the seriousness of the issue that has been raised by Nicola Murray. And Nicola Murray is one of my constituents, and one of the points I've tried to explain to Nicola is just to understand the significance of the fact that we are gathered here this afternoon in this chamber, devoting our entire afternoon business to the consideration of this petition. Because if ever there was an example of what is the triumph of the design of this parliamentary system, it is that one member of the public, with an absolutely harrowing experience, is able to find some, and I stress the word some, solace from the fact that her Parliament is able to respond to the suffering that she has endured and provide the opportunity for the government to be challenged by the petition to come to committee, the committee to consider it, to overcome the necessary process of scrutiny of these petitions, because there are many petitions that come to Parliament, for the committee to decide that is of such importance that the government should be challenged about it, for the minister to respond to it, and for us to then be here to have this debate all afternoon. That's not only a triumph for the design of our parliamentary system, it's a triumph for my constituent Nicola Murray, who has endured inexplicable suffering and has been able to bring this issue to us. And my constituent brings a very significant issue to us, because what she challenges us to think about is whether the existing arrangements, which we all in good faith have put in place, are actually adequate to deal with the circumstances that people face. When I think through some of the issues that are involved in this case, I think about, and I've discussed this with Ms Murray, these events took place before the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 was in force. And I wonder, in my mind, would it have been any different had that law been in force? Would that have given more protection to my constituent than was the case, than has actually been the case with our existing system? But it brings for me a wider experience, which has come from how I've spent a large part of the last year in sitting in the Criminal Justice Committee, and in particular in the last few months scrutinising the Victims and Witnesses Scotland Bill, which is currently before the committee and which Parliament has approved at stage one. Because the evidence we took at committee was harrowing again of the experience of victims. And we have, I think, really strong legislative frameworks in place just now, but we've just taken testimony from members of the public, which is in some cases really impossible to listen to at times. So I think we've got to remain open as a Parliament, and I encourage the government to do likewise, to questioning in our minds, which is the heart of the Nicola Murray petition, are our arrangements actually adequate and fit for purpose? And I quite understand, and I very much take the point that both Maggie Chapman and Maurice Golden have made in the debate, that the exact proposition that is put forward by Nicola Murray might not be perfect. But as we all know, as we scrutinise legislation, a stage two process, a proposal will be put forward and it's maybe just not perfect, and the government will take it away and work with a member and come back at stage three with a refined proposition that everybody agrees will work. I hope we can leave today's debate with members of Parliament and with the Justice and Home Affairs Secretary able to consider whether this might not be the perfect solution, but a solution there needs to be found to address the circumstances that my constituent has experienced. Now, that solution, as I listen to the debate, as I listen particularly to the intervention of Mr Green on the Cabinet Secretary, I'm left question in my mind whether the answer to this lies in sentencing guidelines or a new offence. That's the question I've got in my mind, because I understand exactly where the Cabinet Secretary is coming from, that we have judicial independence and we've got operational independence for the police and operational independence for the Crown. But going back to what Mr Carlo said, I don't think any of us can look at the experience of my constituent and say a £300 fine feels appropriate. And so that's the question I think that this petition forces us to encounter and to consider. What is the right approach? Is it a new offence, or is it to recognise that sentencing guidelines are not appropriate? So my plea to the government today would be not to close the door on this case, but to leave the door open for further consideration of what is the appropriate way to address the unquestionable suffering of my constituent. And we should address her suffering by commending her courage and doing something about it.
Thank you, Mr Swinney. And I now call Sharon Dowie, who will be the last speaker in the open debate before I move to closing speeches. Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Domestic abuse is a despicable and evil crime. It is particularly abhorrent when it also results in harm to a child. I cannot imagine how harrowing it is for a mother to be to go through the cruelty of domestic abuse, only for the attack to be made more harrowing because it results in miscarriage, stillbirth, or forces the termination of a pregnancy against their will. To anyone in that situation, this whole Parliament's thoughts are with you. We all want to do all we can for women suffering this dreadful situation. It's our duty to give those women whatever help we can, so they at least receive some measure of justice. I also want to pay tribute to the petitioner who is in the chamber today, in the gallery, sorry, who has brought this proposal forward. Nicola Murray has lost three babies as a result of domestic violence. Her evidence to the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee said, "I was absolutely devastated and grief-stricken. I felt incredibly let down because, in my experience, the law, as it currently stands, offered no protection or redress. I believe that the current law cannot adequately prosecute perpetrators who cause such loss through their violent actions or coercive control." I'm sure we're all touched by the power of Ms Murray's words and what she's been through. Even one person in this position is a tragedy. The change to the law she is seeking seems right. It is reasonable and fair. It identifies and fixes an apparent loophole in current legislation. I note evidence that the committee heard which found that similar offences to the one she is seeking are already in operation elsewhere. In England and Wales, as well as Northern Ireland, when someone deliberately causes the death of a fetus through violence, they can be charged with that, and there are a number of examples of this being used in recent cases. There are also examples further afield, such as the New York Penal Code, where the definition of homicide includes causing the death of a person as well as an unborn child. I also note a lot of the evidence that the committee heard, which established that it is not easy to seek prosecutions in this scenario by using other laws. While some other laws appear to be possible options, in practice they cannot guarantee appropriate punishment. That leaves the need to create a specific offence that enables courts to hand down longer sentences for perpetrators of domestic violence which cause miscarriage. The Domestic Abuse Act 2018, of course, does include a new statutory aggravation where the offence involves a child, but it does not appear to cover an unborn child. I can see no reason why this legal change should not be made. I was not convinced by evidence from the Crown Office, which suggested that existing practices are appropriate to cover the death of an unborn child. The Crown Office said that prosecutors exercise professional judgment when deciding a charge, and that miscarriage would reflect that charge. The Crown Office also highlighted the creation of the offence of engaging in a course of behaviour which is abusive of a partner or ex-partner in the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018. while I recognise the Crown's position that the result of a forced termination within the context of domestic abuse could fall into the parameters of this offence, I'm not sure it is suitable in practice. As such, I welcome the proposal from Dr Mary Neal, a reader in law at the University of Strathclyde, who suggested a reform to the existing legislation to include a new offence. She said that offence should cover behaviour contributing to the ending of a partner's or ex-partner's pregnancy. In the proposal, a person commits an offence when the person contributes or attempts to contribute to the end of their partner or ex-partner's pregnancy and intends for that behaviour to contribute to the end of the pregnancy, or is reckless and such behaviour leads to the end of the pregnancy. It would give women in this terrible situation some small measure of justice. Given how harrowing this situation must be, that is only right. In terms of how to proceed, I also want to briefly highlight something which was raised by the Petitions Committee, which is that there are already too many members' bills to pass during this current legislative session. As a result, I hope the Government will look to step in and expedite the process as only the Government can. This should be consensual and a unanimous change to the law. I believe it should be fast-tracked through by the Government as quickly as possible. And just before I conclude, I want to remind the Chamber of the case of Lisa Donaldson. Stabbed, punched, throttled, all while 32 weeks pregnant. He caused her a spinal cord injury, brain damage, extensive bruising and numerous other injuries. Her unborn twins died as a result. He received just 5 years in prison. Presiding Officer, the women who suffer the horrific crime of domestic abuse and the harrowing distress of miscarriage deserve to be heard. They deserve a change to the law. They should not be made to wait many years before they receive justice. The Government and every party in this Parliament should act urgently now. Thank you.
Thank you. And we move to winding up speeches. I call on Maggie Chapman. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm encouraged to have witnessed and been part of such a thoughtful and considered debate this afternoon. There is a significant degree of cross-party consensus on this vital issue. And where there is not agreement, I am hopeful that ongoing conversations might enable and support the shifting of some views and that we might see progress on each of the recommendations of the Petitions Committee. Again, I would like to thank the petitioner for her testimony and her work, and to reiterate my willingness to work with her and others in achieving robust and effective change. As many have said this afternoon, pregnancy should be a happy time. Families should be able to look forward to the birth of a new life with hope and excitement. No one should fear a pregnancy in case it triggers abuse. No one should have to suffer abuse because or when they are pregnant. The loss of a pregnancy, as Pauline McNeill, Claire Hockey and others have highlighted, must be one of the most traumatic events imaginable. To have this happen as a consequence of domestic violence only compounds and complicates the pain, trauma, loss and grief those affected go through. And then to have the criminal justice system fail survivors, the phrase adding insult to injury doesn't even come close. As Claire Hockey and John Swinney have so clearly articulated, we must ensure that the approaches and systems we have in place to support survivors are the right ones and do what we need them to do, and that they do so with compassion in ways that really do deliver justice. I was grateful to Faisal Chowdhury, Pam Gosal and others for also highlighting the importance of having well-resourced organisations to support survivors. The third sector organisations we know do phenomenal life-saving work, and I am grateful to them. It is clear to me that we do need a change in law along the lines outlined by the petitioner and developed by Dr Neal, addressing abuse which either intentionally or recklessly ends a wanted pregnancy. There are likely to be different ways of delivering this, and we must ensure that if we go down this route, we ensure that there can be no impact on abortion law or questions of legal personhood. Across this chamber, we have different views about some of these issues. But as the passing of stage one of Gillian Mackay's Safe Access Zones bill this week showed, we can come together, despite those differences, to protect those whose rights and well-being are under threat. In the same way, I believe that we can cooperate to fill the legal gap which the petitioner has so eloquently and movingly described. And I urge the Scottish Government to ensure that this work has the time and resources which it needs and deserves. Of course, we all wish we did not need such laws. They only come into play when the worst has already happened, when people have already suffered and lost. So we must also consider, in all we do, how best to address the root causes of domestic abuse, that malignant hostility towards those who are pregnant or who have recently given birth. That's why our work on misogyny, potentially groundbreaking and transformative, must continue, must be courageous, must be rooted in the real experience of survivors, like today's petitioner. Today's debate has perhaps given us a glimpse of a Scotland we'd perhaps prefer not to see. Indeed, we have been confronted with the failings both of the state and of wider society to protect, support, nurture and lift up our fellow human beings. But if we are to change it, if we are to create a world where laws such as those we discussed today are not needed anywhere near as often as they currently are, if at all, we cannot turn away. We must look, we must see, and we must act. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Katie Clark. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you. And I'm pleased to close this debate on behalf of Scottish Labour. And we congratulate the petitioner, Nicola Murray, on bringing this issue to the Scottish Parliament and for her courage in sharing her personal experiences. We welcome the opportunity to consider whether the law in this area is adequate. We know that, historically, the justice system has treated the victims of domestic abuse very poorly and indeed has often not treated domestic abuse as a crime. We must all recognise that there has been significant progress over recent decades. However, there is still a long way to go. As has been said by Polly McNeill, Fulton McGregor, Fousal Troudry and others, pregnancy loss is not an uncommon feature of domestic abuse. Pregnant women in particular are often a target of male partners, and there is often a rise in violence against women during pregnancy. As Polly McNeill said, pregnancy can alter the pattern of assault, with pregnant women more likely to be struck on the abdomen. We recognise that Scots law has always allowed the facts of a case and the injury to be narrated by the Crown as part of an assault, and that the Scots legal system has always had a far more flexible approach than in England and Wales. As the Cabinet Secretary said, there is already provision in Scots law for pregnancy loss, and the intense distress this can cause, which could be lifelong, to be taken into account in sentencing. In summing up, or indeed after this debate, it would be very helpful to get more detail from the Scottish Government as to whether the sentences which are being given by the courts in such situations are adequate. There have been a number of members who have spoke about... Yes, I'll take an intervention from Jamie Green.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank all members for taking my interventions? I didn't have a speaking slot in today's debate, but it's a very important one. I'm keen to involve myself in it. I was quite struck by the responses to the Petitions Committee, a small report into it by the Crown itself, who made clear that the Crown was confident that they're able to libel and accuse where they believe there was evidence of, I quote, forced termination. But that presumably would only relate to the situation of coerced abortion, for example, and not necessarily consequential loss as a result of domestic violence. I wondered if perhaps that's something that the government could look at, whether DASA is the right vehicle for addressing this, or, as John Swinney said, that the sentencing guidelines itself would be a better vehicle to deliver the same result.
Katie Clark.
I welcome that intervention from Jamie Green, who always makes very helpful contributions to these debates. So I'm glad that he's been able to make a very short contribution on this occasion. A number of members have spoken about specific cases, and obviously we're not aware of every case, but I think it is appropriate that we consider whether those cases have been dealt with adequately and whether sentences are appropriate. But in relation to the specific point that Jamie Green is making, my understanding has always been that it's been possible for the Crown to narrate those facts and the injuries suffered, but obviously that will be at the point of sentencing, and we won't always know the long-term impact that an assault, an injury can have on a woman who's experienced pregnancy loss. The Cabinet Secretary spoke about the work that the Sentencing Council are undertaking relating to domestic abuse and the work of the Domestic Abuse Justice Partners Roundtable. It would be helpful if she could keep the Criminal Justice Committee advised of that work. Pam Gossall spoke about the appalling circumstances which led Nicola Murray to petition this Parliament. And it is the responsibility of this Parliament to ensure that the justice system deals with violence against women effectively where there is pregnancy loss and that there are effective sentences available to the court which are being used. So we need to recognise that pregnancy and indeed having children makes women more vulnerable. As John Swinney said, the Criminal Justice Committee have been scrutinising the Victims and Witnesses Bill and have been given a great deal of consideration as to how the justice system fails women. We've also carried out post-legislative scrutiny on the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018, and we're of the view that this has been an effective piece of legislation. But I do think we need to look more carefully at sentencing in cases such as Nicola Murray's to see whether sentencing is being effectively administered in pregnancy loss and whether either through a new offence or indeed through other mechanisms such as the Sentencing Council, there needs to be further attention. And indeed, whatever mechanism is used, I think we need to look at the maximum penalties which are attached to offences. These sentences are available to the court now. It would be helpful to know from the Scottish Government whether the Lord Advocate believes that there is need to strengthen the law in this area, the view that the Crown Office take on their ability to prosecute in such cases, and whether there is concern that the courts are giving lenient sentences. There's been a number of references to what happens in England and Wales, particularly from Maurice Golden and Pam Gossall, and it would be helpful if the Cabinet Secretary could advise if sentences are indeed more lenient in Scotland. In general, sentences are not more lenient in Scotland, but it would be helpful to get more information from the Scottish Government in relation to that. I would conclude by thanking Nicola Murray again for bringing this issue to this Parliament. I hope that going forward, this Parliament scrutinises both the law and the practice that has been administered by the courts to ensure that the issues raised by this petition are properly addressed. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Alexander Stewart, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This afternoon's debate has provided an opportunity to explore the important issue in detail, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. This petition has been under consideration for much of the current parliamentary session, and I welcome this debate being brought into Parliament today. When Nicola Murray first submitted her petition, I helped to scrutinise these proposals as a member then of the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee. I'd also like to thank the committee clerks for their assistance with this process, as well as those who gave written and oral evidence. And of course, Nicola herself. As we have heard today, she has had the courage and the tenacity to bring forward this petition and be supported by organisations like Scottish Women's Aid and Victim Support Scotland. It's vitally important that we discuss this issue, and to have it in the chamber today is of real importance because that does shine a light on the issue. And we've already heard that the loss can also have an impact on other members of the family, losing a sibling or losing a grandchild. And we know that the current justice system can leave victims feeling like the perpetrator has not been brought to justice. And we've heard that today. Many members have brought that forward in the leniency of the information and what happens to individuals in cases like this. And that needs to change. The petition brought forward by Nicola has highlighted several issues around the effects of domestic abuse and of coercive control, and these need to be exposed for the problems that they deal with within the Scottish system. Since the Domestic Abuse Act in 2018, Police Scotland's approach to domestic abuse has improved, but, Presiding Officer, it needed to improve. However, there are still gaps within the system that have been proved and have been shown when it comes to this type of control and what has taken place. Nicola spoke about much more that has to be done to support victims through the current process and how victims can sometimes struggle to be taken seriously when they're dealing with this type of issue. Domestic abuse still doesn't be taken seriously. And we've heard today about groups like Brodie's Trust, which were there to support. Now, that's fantastic that we have these organisations and charities and trusts that are there to support, but they need to be supported by our own judicial system and our own police force system at the same time. During the scrutiny of this petition, the committee raised the possibility of a new requirement that could be introduced, which would ensure that the violence that leads to the loss of an unborn child is always mentioned when the perpetrator is charged. This could be one possible alternative to creation of a completely new criminal offence for actions which lead to the loss of an unborn child. On this issue, the Scottish Sentencing Council has stated that there is nothing in the current sentencing guidelines which would prevent this requirement from becoming a reality, Presiding Officer. As Nicola herself highlighted, there are very few examples of cases where the type of referral is actually put against the charge. So while some of the legal framework may exist, it is very clear that it's not effective enough and there should be more that should be done. Now, we've had some excellent contributions this afternoon. And as I said earlier, Presiding Officer, this shows the strength of this Parliament when we can have a discussion, a debate of this nature in the Chamber. And as the convener, Jackson Carlow, said in his very impressive and excellent and motive speech, that the committee role here has a real place and should be praised for the role it's taken. There is no doubt that this type of process in this Parliament is and gives a real asset to the Scottish Parliament, and it shows that a petition of this calibre come forward, and we can ensure that a review can take place. Now, the Cabinet Secretary herself spoke about the cooperation and the collaboration and the challenges within this petition, but she also acknowledged that more needs to be done, and I look forward to hearing in our summing up as to where we can take this. My colleague Pam Gosso spoke about the loss and the fear and the shame and the silence that can happen under these, and that four pregnant women every day are abused. And that in itself is a harrowing situation that we find ourselves in here in Scotland. Polly McNeill spoke about the fear that victims go through and the loss that they deal with, and that women should not be being put in this position by men. It's the men that we need to manage in this situation, and that's important, that has to be, and we need to be tough with sentencing of these men. I mean, Maurice Golden spoke about the harrowing experience, being badly let down, and the pathetic compensation of £300 in this situation that was, you know, it's insulting to say the least. Sharon Dowie spoke about this evil crime and the lack of justice that requires. But John Swinney spoke very eloquently about the effectiveness of the committee and shone a light on how the committee has. And it is a prime example of what this Parliament can do and has the ability to do on an issue of this nature, when an individual can bring forward such an important issue and it can be given the respect and it can be given the amount of support that's required, and government can make some changes. So I look forward to seeing that. Others have spoken. I mean, Claire Hawkey, and Maggie Chapman, Fulton MacGregor and Fazil Chaudhry all made very passionate speeches about the situation and circumstances. Presiding officer, sir, this petition has shone a light, as I've said, on many issues, but it's not possible to cover everything. But I hope that this debate will ensure that the Scottish Government will look at the highlighting what has happened in supporting organisations, by supporting groups and campaigners like Nicola herself, who have led the charge on this. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, it's vitally important that these appalling crimes of domestic abuse, coercive control, are dealt with so we can ensure that our justice system is proper and fit for purpose. I look forward to seeing this debate progress and the issues that we have seen continue. And I join with colleagues in hoping to see a real change and improvement on this issue, because it's clearly a long overdue. With all of us working together, we will ensure that a solution can be found, and solutions need to be found for people like Nicola. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Jackson Carlaw started this afternoon's debate by asking for a review of the legal framework and the wider systems that seek to support victims and survivors. And I want to assure Mr Carlaw and Parliament that we are and will continue to do both. And that is in part through our very constructive engagement with the Petitions Committee, the debate that we have all participated in this afternoon, but it also has a wider hinterland in terms of our cross-government agenda to tackle and end violence against women and girls, whether that's through the Equally Safe strategy, the Victims Task Force, which both myself and the Lord Advocate co-chair, or the Domestic Abuse Justice Partners Roundtable, which this matter will indeed be referred to. And I also want to make very clear to Parliament that no doors are ever closed, and that solutions still have to be found, because our journey on ending violence against women and girls is far, far from over. And I agree with Pam Gossel. We must confront the uncomfortable truths. There are 61,000 incidents reported to Police Scotland most recently. But we know, as Maggie Chapman says, that these crimes are underreported, quite possibly by 30 to 40%. And indeed, the SCGIS found that under a sixth of those surveyed, 16% of people who have experienced domestic abuse in the previous 12 months only go to the police. So we have a serious issue of underreporting in this country. And Claire Hawkey, Pauline McNeill and others spoke to the danger, the heightened danger, that amplified danger that pregnant women face when they are in an abusive relationship. And as Pauline McNeill and Katie Clark always do, they always speak very informed and eloquently about Scots law, and Fulton MacGregor spoke about some of the strengths of our legal system in and around the flexibility that it has, not least with the common law offences of assault that appear in the High Court and the unlimited sentencing opportunities that go with that. But what I've also heard from each and every member who's participated in this debate to do is there is further work to do on some of the issues that have been highlighted by committee this afternoon. And I won't repeat Marcia Scott's evidence that I referenced earlier when she spoke of the unintended consequences based on the English and Welsh experience. But let me stress to Parliament that those experiences and those unintended consequences are not a reason to do nothing, but they give us every reason to learn from that experiences. And I was very struck by the evidence from Dr. Mary Neal when she put forward the proposition that an aspect that could be assessed further is whether a new statutory aggravation could be considered which relates to domestic abuse offending. Such an aggravation has been suggested not just by Dr. Mary Neal today, but also by others, and indeed the intervention from Mr. Green throughout the debate. And it also appears, I believe, to have some support from the petitioner. And while much more work would be needed to assess how it may be done, one advantage a new aggravation would have over development of a new offence is that it would not seek to criminalise any new activity, but instead would potentially allow the court to acknowledge the specific seriousness that arises when an existing offence is committed against a pregnant woman. And the benefit and advantage of aggravation or aggravated offences is that it does give the opportunity to recognise and label behaviours for what they are. It gives us an opportunity to more robustly and evidently acknowledge when harm is done, and in this case, when harm is done to an unborn child as a result of domestic violence. And that's why, in my opening remarks, Presiding Officer, I made very clear that the issues raised today would indeed be subject to further consideration, full consideration by the Scottish Government, and that our work with our domestic abuse justice partners is very important in that regard, to ensure that whatever next steps we take, that we get them absolutely right. I would also just quickly highlight, Presiding Officer, that the work of the Sentencing Council in all of this is important. They do consult on all guidelines in draft before they are finalised. So it is open to anyone to make representations to the Council about specific matters that should be covered in the guideline, and I'm sure that we can facilitate the parliamentary debate that's been held today for that to be drawn to the attention of the Sentencing Council in their deliberations. Presiding Officer, this Parliament in its 25-year history has placed a heavy focus on tackling domestic abuse and violence against women and girls, and it is something that we have all endeavoured to work collaboratively on. And if there is any hope to be taken from today's debate, I have no doubt that we will all continue to face in the same direction and try our best to march forward together. The personal testimony and campaigns have continued to reinvigorate all our energies and all our commitments day in, day out, to do more to support victims of domestic abuse, but also crucially to tackle the root causes of the vile and cowardly behaviour. And I and this Government and this Parliament, that we will all work together, I am sure, and look to deliver the step changes in our response to the crimes of domestic and violence. And I think it is one thing that I hope that the petitioner can take some hope and some solace in terms of the tone and tenor of the debate and the actions that I have outlined. And my grateful thanks, most of all, to the petitioner, but also to the convener and the committee members and to everybody who's participated in today's debate.
Thank you. And I call on David Torrance to wind up the debate on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like firstly to thank members for their thoughtful and compassionate contributions in today's debate. As the convener set out earlier, and many colleagues, including Pauline McNeill, have mentioned throughout, we can be left in little doubt about the devastating impact of miscarriage which has been caused by domestic abuse. My colleagues across the chamber today have all touched on Nicola's testimony and contributions to his petition. Claire Hawkey spoke of Nicola's bravery and tenacity. Jackson Carlow spoke of her courage and determination. Philip McGregor spoke of her motivation, and Johnny Soney spoke of her harrowing experience and suffering. We are all grateful to her, and I would also like to put on record my thanks to petitioner Nicola Murray for her dedication to the issue and my admiration for the way she has worked to support other victims of domestic abuse. As a Parliament, we have considered how to tackle domestic abuse for many years, and it is an issue which gathers support from members across all parties representing this chamber today. This support has been evident throughout the debate this afternoon, in contributions from Pam Gospel, Maurice Golden and Katie Clark, and all the speakers. And I would like to reiterate that our work on this petition has been profoundly moving. The committee considers a high volume of petitions, each with its own background and often with a personal story from a petitioner. The role of our committee is often to amplify the voice of a petitioner and put her case to the Scottish Government. It's a testament to Nicola's hard work that we are here this afternoon debating this petition. As a committee, do we not routinely hear from petitioners simply because of the volume of petitions that we receive? However, we have all considered that it would be helpful in this particular instance to give Nicola Murray an opportunity to speak to us about why her petition is important. Nicola's evidence was compelling. She spoke with great passion and feeling about how life-impacting it is, not just for the victims, but for their families. Speaking of her own experience, she says, "I lost my pregnancy. I lost a child. I lost children. My children lost siblings, and my parents lost grandchildren. So it impacts the entire family. Obviously, afterwards, it is deeply traumatising and emotional, and it is not just that you have to deal with the loss itself, it is the circumstances of a loss, adding further trauma to victims and their families because they feel like they have not had or received justice. I am in agreement that we should work to prevent this type of abuse from happening in the first place. We recognise that there is not a single solution to this complex problem, and I know that we will all continue to work towards this collective goal of tackling domestic abuse and gender-based violence. The proposals in this petition is quite specific. The petition aims to secure a justice that is appropriate and appropriate to recognise the trauma caused by this type of abuse. We are aware of Scottish Government's concerns that it would be difficult to evidence a crime of this nature, but that does not mean that we should simply do nothing. Dr Mary Neal told the committee we should remember that other crimes with primarily women victims are underreported. Difficult to persuade people to come and give evidence about and prosecute with varying levels of success, but we do not suggest that there should not be crimes for that reason. Just because a rape might be difficult to prosecute or difficult to get a victim to report because it might be traumatic for a victim to do so and go through a process, we do not say that it should not be a crime. We recognise the concerns raised by Scottish Women's Aid. And Jackson Carlow, a convener, highlighted in detail the concerns raised in evidence from Scottish Women's Aid around coercive and controlling behaviour here in the Chamber today. It is right that we consider the potential or unintended consequences. We must not underestimate the importance of ensuring that we do not risk criminalising victims. Northern Ireland achieved this by changing the relevant offence to ensure that women and their doctors could no longer be prosecuted under abortion law. If a new offence were to be created, this could be designed to make sure that it is separated from the abortion law. The Scottish Government believes that more work is required before we can consider introducing a new offence. However, we are all in agreement that we must find a way to protect pregnant women from this harrowing form of domestic abuse. And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's statement around the Scottish Government's forum on domestic abuse later this year. I would like to thank members across the Chamber for the sensitive and considerate manner in which they have conducted the debate this afternoon. I'd also like to put on the record our thanks to the committee, clerks for all their hard work, to Spice and, of course, to everyone that has contributed to our work so far, either through our evidence sessions or written submissions to the committee. Our committee has heard powerful testimony from petitioner and thoughtful evidence from stakeholders. We have heard about long-term lasting impact of losing a pregnancy through domestic abuse and considerable challenges for those women who attempt to seek justice. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the committee understands that the proposal is one of many ways to address domestic abuse and gender-based violence more broadly. We recognise that there is a long way to go to implementation of the Domestic Abuse Act, and it will take a concerted, multi-organisational approach to tackling this problem. However, we believe that suffering pregnancy loss as a result of domestic abuse is a unique and traumatic experience which merits recognition in its own right. I'd like to finish once again by thanking Nicola Murray for submitting this petition and raising this important issue, and look forward to engagement with the Scottish Government in the future.
Thank you. That concludes the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee debate on petition PE1887. Point of order, Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I understand that earlier this afternoon, Maurice Golden suggested that I had misled the Chamber by my pointing to the higher electricity transmission charges faced in the north of Scotland. I would, with your permission, seek to put on the record that my comments were based on a statement by the Director of Business Planning at SSEN, who in February 2021 said transmission use of system charges are indeed many, many times higher in the north of Scotland than elsewhere in Great Britain. Can I suggest that rather than making accusations, Mr Gold might want to take up his debate about this point with SSEN, though I have nothing to indicate that they are wrong.
Thank you, Mr Allen. I think we're probably all clear that the content of members' contributions is ordinarily a matter for the member. While your comments are on the record, that is not a point of order. I will return to where I was in saying that we have just concluded the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee debate on petition PE1887, Create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business. And I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. And I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And there is one question to be put as a result of today's business, and that question is that motion 12995 in the name of Jackson Carlaw on behalf of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee on petition PE1887, Create an Unborn Victims of Violence Act, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.